Senator Waldo, Senator Thibodeau, requested a ruling under LD-1546, properly before the body. Having anticipated this question, the chair has worked with the Secretary of the Senate to research past action and components of the bill before us today. LD-1546 has been reported out of the Joint Standing Committee on Veterans and Legal Affairs pursuant to Joint Order 2013, Senate Paper 496, following months of work by the committee. Public hearings and work sessions were properly held on all three components of the bill. If the question is to whether the expansion of health care coverage is properly before the body, the same question could have been raised the day the bill originated this conversation, LD-238, the governor's bill, which dealt with the state's wholesale liquor contract and paying the hospitals. As we all know, it's not uncommon for this legislature and every legislature before us to see, at times, legislation that addresses complex issues. This is one of them. In looking at the full, complete picture, LD-1546, the parts are related. Expanding health care coverage will reduce future debt to our hospitals, which we are paying with money from the state's renegotiated liquor contract. So it is this chair's decision that this bill is properly before this body.
And thank you, Mr. President. If I may, just wanted to make a few points here this afternoon.
The Senator may proceed.
Mr. President, obviously, Senate Republicans are somewhat disappointed as to the nature of the way this bill has got to this point. Obviously, the Legal and Veterans Affairs Committee did not debate Medicaid expansion. They didn't put the same time and energy into that as they did other aspects of this bill, which is very unfortunate. I think that most of us realize that there was a fair amount of politics that was involved in that decision. I think that's unfortunate. This morning, or last week, we were told on Friday afternoon that we had to tell 9 a.m. to submit our amendments. Senate Republicans appreciate the fact that we were given until noon to submit any amendments on this very large bill. It was still extremely short every time. We're extremely disappointed that this morning we began debate on this bill before that timeline had even elapsed. That's a little concerning. Maybe it's more than a little concerning. As we work towards finishing the work of the 126th Maine legislature, we've got some incredibly important issues to debate in this chamber. Some incredibly important issues that we have to resolve together. I can remember the Senate President, when he was the assistant minority leader, sitting right here to my right, on multiple occasions, standing to his feet and talking about things that were ramrodded through by the majority. That's not a term I'm going to use today. I'll let each one of you decide whether or not that's been happening. But I certainly am concerned. We need to work together on all the important issues that face this city. Over an hour ago, during the debate, we were told that Maine hospitals don't oppose linking of the bills. I would suggest to you that in an editorial in the Portland Press Herald dated May 12th by Stephen Mission, who was the president of the Maine Hospitals Association, he said the following: Medicaid expansion is a centerpiece of the Federal Affordable Care Act. While hospitals support Medicaid expansion, we vehemently disagree that expansion should be tied in any way to whether or not the outstanding bills get paid. Hospitals don't control whether Medicaid gets expanded. They shouldn't be punished if the expansion fails. Let me say, Senate Republicans want to pay Maine hospitals. The pending report is a distraction from accomplishing this task. join my colleagues in expressing disappointment in how this bill was amended late in the committee process and links two very different proposals together in Washington-style politics. I think that's unfortunate. There are a lot of different facts and figures and numbers surrounding Part C of this bill. Medicaid expansion. It has been said that this is free money from Washington, D.C., and that it won't cost Maine a dime. I can assure you that if we accept Medicaid expansion today, it will cost Maine money. In fact, in fiscal years 2018 and 2019, it will cost Maine over $100 million in new spending. We need to wait, Mr. President. We need to wait. We need to allow our chief executive and his administration time that is necessary to negotiate the best deal for the state of Maine. What does this mean, the best deal for Maine? Well, let's consider our childless adult population. It has been reported that the leaders of this legislature have received a letter from the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services saying the childless adult populations would, quote, likely qualify for 100% coverage from the federal government. Meanwhile, no such letter has been sent to the administration, so we do not yet have a guarantee that Maine will indeed qualify for 100% coverage of this population. I am told that, in fact, the Department of Health and Human Services asked CMS if they could stop their analysis needed to make sure that Maine would qualify for this coverage. CMS said, no, keep working. That tells me simply that this is not a guaranteed 100%. We need to prove to CMS that we will, in fact, qualify. Let's set that aside. How about low-income parents? Currently, our states have not been as generous as Maine covering low-income parents. These states will receive 100% coverage from the federal government for expanding from their current rate, some below 50%. Is that the best deal for the state of Maine? All the way to 133%. Meanwhile, Maine is not going to receive that same benefit. Maine will receive no such benefit. Increasing federal coverage to this population should be negotiated by our state with the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. That's what our administration is trying to do today. Mr. President, we have waiting lists for some of the most vulnerable populations in this state. Our elderly are developmentally disabled. These people who need our assistance today but cannot get help because we cannot afford to help them. Just yesterday we heard that we do not have enough money to cover, or that we do have enough money to cover Maine care for the rest of this fiscal year. We cannot expand to include more able-bodied citizens when we cannot pay for those services that need them, for folks that need them the most. Mr. President, we have expanded our safety net so far that people are slipping through the cracks. When you are looking to expand a third floor to a building, you check the foundation first. The foundation of our main care program is broken. It's foolish to think that adding another layer to it will make it hold up any better. Now, there's no question what fate awaits this bill. There's been zero debate about our one thing that really concerns me, okay? That's zero debate today about our ability to pay for this. Remember, 100% federal money for 3 years. $100 million if the federal government delivers on a promise that they've made to fund it 90%. Given the financial situation that we find ourselves in as a state, who in this chamber thinks that at the end of 3 years, unless our economy dramatically improves, how will we possibly fund this? It's not fair to give somebody something today, just to turn to them tomorrow and say, well, we've changed our mind. This body hasn't shown any potential over the past 2 or 3 decades to staff any program and then make that really tough decision when the resources aren't there to end it. I think that the debate in this chamber is lacking when it comes to whether or not we can afford this program. We're expecting the federal government, as Senator Mason said earlier, that can't afford to open Acadia National Park, can't afford to give children tours of the White House, to deliver on hundreds of millions of dollars, all the while reducing reimbursement rates for a vast number of other programs that we all have supported over the past decades. Asking Maine to give a bigger and bigger percentage of its budget to carry these programs, to keep them for Maine people. I think it's very unfortunate that we would go down that road. Mr. President, I would urge you and all my colleagues to reject this motion